Recorded Books and RB Digital present Bridging Infinity, edited by Jonathan Strahan, narrated by Suzie Athens, Ron Butler, Mimi Chang, Fiona Hardingham, Soneela Nankani, Michael Rahhal, and Michael Welch.
Bridging Infinity by Jonathan Strahan. Introduction. Science fiction is about thinking big and dreaming bigger. Okay, it's not always about that, but it often is. SF can be about a lot of things. But when I started reading science fiction, what grabbed me were stories that implied something greater, that opened out to a staggering, often cosmic scale. Whether it was what was implied in stories like Clark's Childhood's End and The 9 Billion Names of God, the endless grandeur of Asimov's Trantor, or the almost giddy galaxy-smashing scale of early E.E. Doc Smith. The sense of wonder was what made me want to keep reading science fiction. The sense of wonder, though, is out of fashion these days. Nonetheless, it has played an important part in the project that is science fiction, and I think it's still relevant today. Jeff Pruker's Brave New Words, The Oxford Dictionary of Science Fiction, defines sense of wonder as a feeling of awakening or awe triggered by an expansion of one's awareness of what is possible or by confrontation with the vastness of space and time as brought on by reading science fiction. It is science fiction's version of the sublime, which in art is defined as that quality of greatness, whether physical, moral, intellectual, metaphysical, aesthetic, spiritual, or artistic, which especially refers to greatness beyond all possibility of calculation, measurement, or imitation. Something awe-inspiring, in the truest sense, and it is often expressed in physical terms. When I was thinking about this, I began to wonder if there could be such a thing as a mechanical sublime, an engineering sublime, an instance where the tools we produce to address a problem or which we create for their own intrinsic value are of sufficient scale, sufficient scope, that they evoke a sense of awe and veneration that is similar to the sublime in art. Something like the Krell machines in Forbidden Planet. It seemed possible, and it might connect with one of science fiction's basic tenets, that problems can be solved. Science fiction, or at least the sort of science fiction that was typical in American pulp magazines from the 1930s to the 1950s, was founded on a belief that problems are solvable, and that those problems are solvable using technical or engineering solutions. When faced with a problem in a story in John W. Campbell's Astounding, our engineering hero wouldn't quail before the challenge, but would instead science the shit out of it, as Andy Weir so elegantly put it, and come up with an engineering solution to the problem. And sometimes it would take a big solution, a Hoover Dam or maybe moving a planet or two. It was what had worked for the American dream throughout the first half of the 20th century. But as the atomic age came and went, we began to doubt it. And some of that doubt carries on today. Why? By the 1960s, the world seemed more complex, darker, more difficult, and the sort of human problems we face seemed to require something other than a better screwdriver, a smarter mousetrap, or a backyard-built rocket ship. With the new wave science fiction turned inwards and, to some extent, began to set sense of wonder to one side. Not that it ever went away, but it seemed like a hoarier, more cliched, less complex way to solve a problem in a story. And yet, we keep coming back to it, As you can see in any number of hard SF adventures published over the past 30 years, the book you're now holding, Bridging Infinity, is at least in part a new way of asking some old questions. Is solving problems still integral to science fiction? Do we still believe problems are solvable? Can we engineer our way out of the kind of problems we face today and will face in the future? And if we do, if science fiction is still at least partly about solving problems, what scale will we have to face them on? With my mind full of images of Dyson spheres and rings, of star-engulfing AI substrates, and of distinctly terrestrial projects that redirected rivers or reshaped continents, I turned to some of the most interesting science fiction writers working today and asked them to send me stories that looked at super engineering projects. Anything from mad abandoned Soviet plans to reroute rivers to Australian plans to build 3,000-kilometer-long canals to Dyson spheres that enclose stars. Stories about sometimes goofy-sounding projects that capture our sense of wonder while providing a chance to look at everything, from the greatest of humanity's successes to our darkest motivations. These also evoke a sense of awe, a sense of the sublime. The stories could be set here on Earth, in our solar system, or anywhere in the deepest reaches of space. The only criteria was that they be hard SF and relate to a super engineering project or projects. In the end, 15 writers responded, and while they responded in very different ways, there were some similarities that were striking. One group of writers took to the cosmic stage spinning classic tales of hard SF. Gregory Benford and Larry Niven, Allan M. Steele, Robert Reed, Charlie Jane Anders, and Arne Owomoyela, all describing engineering on a mammoth scale that solves a problem. Where are we to live? How will we survive? And so on. They show us life inside enormous spacecraft, intelligences made of plasma living inside stars, and adventure across the surfaces of manufactured worlds so huge they engulf solar systems. There's a real old-fashioned sense of wonder to their stories, alongside an awareness of modern science and engineering. What perhaps surprised me the most, though, and shouldn't have, was the way the other group of writers took the challenge of writing super engineering stories and turned it to addressing one of the greatest problems facing us today. The first story I accepted for Bridging Infinity, Thoreia Dyer's Induction, described an engineering project, enormous in scale, that focused on climate change and global warming. It was followed by stories from Stephen Baxter, Ken Liu, Pat Murphy, and Paul Doherty, and others. Sometimes they involved small-scale engineering with a large-scale effect, and sometimes the scale of the project was much, much bigger. But the sense of wonder was always there. Bridging Infinity isn't a climate change book, but working on it convinced me that science fiction is still about finding solutions, both more and less palatable ones, and that at least for now, finding a solution to climate change is as key for science fiction as it is for the world at large. Science fiction is always changing. It's much broader, more inclusive, less centralized than when I first encountered it. But a lot of what made it special is exactly the same. It asks questions, it believes problems are solvable, and it tries to find those solutions in stories that are filled with action, adventure, and a bit of romance. That's what I see in these stories, and I hope you will as well. Jonathan Strahan, Perth, Western Australia, July 2016.
Chapter 1. 16 Questions for Kamala Chatterjee by Alistair Reynolds. What first drew you to the problem? She smiles, looking down at her lap. She is ready for this. On the day of her thesis defense, she has risen early after a good night's sleep. Her mind is clean and clear as the blue skies over Ueno Park. She has taken the electric train to Keisei Ueno Station and then walked the rest of the way to the university campus. The weather is pleasantly warm for April, and she has worn a skirt for the first time all year. The time is Hanami, the shifting, transient festival of the cherry blossom blooms. Strolling under the trees, along the shadow-dappled paths, families and tourists already gathering, she has tried to think of every possible thing she might be asked. "I like things that don't quite fit," she begins. "Problems that have been sitting around nearly but not quite solved for a long time. Not the big, obvious ones. Keep away from those. But the ones everyone else forgets about because they're not quite glamorous enough. Like the solar P-mode oscillations. I read about them in my undergraduate studies in Mumbai." She is sitting with her hands clenched together over her skirt, knees tight together, wondering why she felt obliged to dress up for this occasion when her examiners have come to work wearing exactly the same casual outfits as usual. Two she knows well, her supervisor and another departmental bigwig. The third, the external examiner, arrived in Tokyo from Nagoya University, but even this one is familiar enough from the corridors. They all know each other better than they know her. Her supervisor and the external advisor must have booked a game of tennis for later. They both have sports bags with racket handles sticking out the side. That's what they're mainly thinking about, she decides. Not her defense, not her thesis, not 3 years of work, but who will do best at tennis. Old grudges, old rivalries, boiling to the surface like the endless upwelling of solar convection cells. Yes, she says, feeling the need to repeat herself. Things that don't fit. That's where I come in. Then she sits back brightly and waits for the next question. When you touched the Chatterjee anomaly, the object that bore your name, the birth name you were given so many centuries ago, what did you feel? Fear, exhilaration, wonder and terror at how far we'd come, how far I'd come, what it had taken to bring me to this point. We'd made one kind of bridge between the surface of the sun and the anomaly, and that was difficult enough. I'd seen every step of it, borne witness to the entire thing from the moment Kuroshio dropped her sliver of hafnium alloy on my desk. Before that even, when I glimpsed the thing in the residuals. But what I hadn't realized, not properly, was that I'd become another kind of bridge, just as strange as the one we drilled down into the photosphere. I'd borne witness to myself, so I ought not to have been so surprised. But I was, and just then it hit me like a tidal wave. From the moment they offered me the prolongation, I'd allowed myself to become something I couldn't explain, something that had its inception far in the past, in a place called Mumbai, and which reached all the way to the present, anchored to this instant, this point in space and time, inside this blazing white furnace. In that moment, I don't think there was anything capable of surprising me more than what I'd turned into. But then I touched the object, and it whispered to me, and I knew I'd been wrong. I still had a capacity for astonishment. That in itself was astonishing. It was only later that I realized how much trouble we were in. Can you express the problem for your doctoral research project in simple terms? Reduce it to its basics? It's a bit like earthquakes, she says, trying to make it seem as if she is groping for a suitable analogy. Ripples in the Earth's crust. The way those ripples spread, the timing and shape of their propagation as they bounce around inside the crust, There's information in those patterns that the seismologists can use. They can start mapping things they wouldn't ordinarily be able to see, like deep faults, like the Tokai fault, out beyond Tokyo Bay. It's the same with the sun. For about 60 years, people have been measuring optical oscillations in the surface of the sun, then comparing them against mathematical models. Helioseismology, mapping the solar interior using what you can deduce from the surface. Glimpsing hidden structure, density changes, reflective surfaces, and so on. It's the only way we can see what's going on. You mentioned Kuroshio. We have records of an individual with that name. She was an academic scientist at the same institution as you, in the same nation-state. This was long before Prometheus Station. Was Kuroshio the first to speculate about the project's ultimate feasibility? Kuroshio was a colleague, a friend. We played football together in the women's squad. Do you know what football was? No, of course you wouldn't. My friend was a solid-state physicist specializing in metallurgy. I knew her a little when I was preparing my thesis, but it was only after I resubmitted it that we got to know each other really well. She showed me around her lab. They had a diamond anvil in there, a tool for producing extremely high pressures, for making materials that didn't exist on Earth, like super-dense hydrogen. One morning, she comes into my office. She had to share one with three postdocs herself, so she envied me having a whole office to myself. I think she's come to talk about training, but instead, Kuroshio drops a handkerchief-sized scrap of paper onto my desk, like it's a gift, and invites me to examine the contents. Is any of this making sense to you? Never mind. All I can see is a tiny sliver of metal, a sort of dirty silver in color. I ask Kuroshio to explain, and she says it's a sample of a new alloy, a blend of hafnium, carbon, and nitrogen cooked up in the solid-state physics lab, like I'm supposed to be impressed. But actually I am, once she starts giving me the background. This is a theoretical material, a substance dreamed up in a computer before anyone worked out how to synthesize it. And the startling thing is, this material could endure 2/3 of the surface temperature of the sun without melting. You know what this means, don't you? She asked me. This is only a beginning. We can think about reaching that crazy alien thing you discovered. We can think about drilling a shaft into the sun. I laughed at her, but I really shouldn't have. Kuroshio was right. What makes you think you might be a suitable candidate for doctoral work? Select one or more answers from the options below. Leave blank if you feel none of the options apply. I am a diligent student. I have studied hard for my degree and always completed my coursework on time. I believe that I have a capacity for independent research. I do not need constant supervision or direction to guide my activities. In fact, I work better alone than in a crowd. I look forward to the day when I can call myself Doctor. I will enjoy the prestige that comes from the title. You felt that the solar heliospheric oscillations would be a fruitful area to explore? No, an inward voice answers sarcastically. I thought that it would be an excellent way to waste 3 years. But she straightens in her chair and tries to make her hands stop wrestling with each other. It's sweaty and close in this too small office. The blinds are drawn, but not perfectly, and sunlight is fighting its way through the gaps. Bars of light illuminate dust in the air, dead flies on the windowsill, the spines of textbooks on the wall behind the main desk. Before I left Mumbai, I'd spent a summer working with Sundragon, a graphics house working on really tough rendering problems. Light tracing, real physics for shoot-'em-up games and superhero movies. I took one look at what those guys were already doing, compared it to the models everyone else was using to simulate the solar oscillations, and realized that the graphic stuff was way ahead. So that's where I knew I had an edge, because I'd soaked up all that knowledge, and no one in astrophysics had a clue how far behind they were. That gave me a huge head start. I still had to build my simulation, of course, and gather the data, and it was a whole year before I was even close to testing the simulation against observations. Then there was a lot of fine-tuning, debugging. They look at graphs and tables, chewing over numbers and interpretation. The colored images of the solar models are very beautiful, with their oddly geometric oscillation modes, like carpets or tapestries wrapped around the sun. P-mode oscillations are the dominant terms, she says, meaning the pressure waves. G-mode oscillations show up in the models, but they're not nearly as significant. P for pressure, G for gravity. The road to Prometheus Station was arduous. Few of us have direct memories of those early days, but the prolongation has given you an unusual, not to say unique, perspective. Do you remember the difficulties? Difficulty was all we knew. We breathed it like air. Every step was monumental. New materials, new cooling methods, each increment bringing us closer and closer to the photosphere. Our probes skimmed and hovered, dancing closer to that blazing edge. They endured for hours, minutes, sometimes seconds. But we pushed closer. Decades of constant endeavor. A century gone, then another. Finally, the first fixed bridgehead, the first physical outpost on the surface of the sun. Prometheus Station. A continent-sized raft of black water lilies floating on a breath of plasma, riding the surge and plunge of cellular convection patterns. Not even a speck on the face of the sun, but a start, a promise. The lilies existed only to support each other, most of their physical structure dedicated to cooling. Threaded with refrigeration channels, pumps as fierce as rocket engines, great vanes and grids turned to space. Each a floating machine the size of a city, and we had to keep building the entire network and throwing it away whenever there was a storm, a mass ejection, or a granulation supercell too big for our engineering to ride out. We got better at everything, slowly. Learned to read the solar weather, to adjust Prometheus Station's position, dancing around the prominences. Decades and decades of failure and frustration, until we managed to survive two complete turns of the sunspot cycle. Slowly, the outpost's complexity increased. To begin with, the only thing we required of it was to endure. That was challenge enough. Then we began to add functionality. Instruments, probes. We drilled down from its underside, pushed feelers into thickening plasma, down 100 kilometers, then 1,000. No thought of people ever living on it. That was still considered absurd. The alignment between your models and the P-mode data is impressive, groundbreaking. It will be of great benefit to those working to gain a better understanding of the energy transport mechanisms inside the sun. Indeed, you go further than that, speculating that a thorough program of modeling and mapping, extending to a real-time project, could give us vital advance warning of adverse solar weather effects by linking emergent patterns in the deep convection layers with magnetic reconnection and mass ejection episodes. That seems a bold statement for a doctoral candidate. Do you wish to qualify it? No. But people came, didn't they? Or what we might call people? Call them what you will. All I know is that we'd got better at stability. 50 years without losing Prometheus Station, then a century. I'd have lived to see none of it if they hadn't offered me the prolongation, but by then I was too vital to the project to be allowed the kindness of dying. And I'm not sorry, really, at least not of those early stages. It was marvelous what we learned to do. I wish Kuroshio had seen it all. I wish they'd been as generous to her as they were with me. I wish she'd been there when the machines constructed a station, a habitable volume on one of the central lilies. Heat wasn't the central problem by then. We could cool any arbitrary part of the station down as low as we liked, provided we accepted a thermal spike elsewhere. Thermodynamics, that's all. Gravity turned out to be the real enemy. 27 Gs. No unaugmented person could survive such a thing for more than a few seconds. So they shaped the first occupants, rebuilt their bodies, their bones and muscle, their circulatory systems. They were slow, lumbering creatures, more like trees or elephants than people. But they could live on the sun. And to the sunwalkers, it was the rest of us who were strange, ephemeral, easily broken. Pitiable, if you want the truth of it. Of course, I had to become one of them. I don't remember who had the idea first, me or them, but I embraced the transformation like a second birth. They sucked out my soul and poured it back into a better, stronger body. Gave me eyes that could stare into the photosphere without blinking. Eyes that could discriminate heat and density and patterns of magnetic force. We strode that bright new world like gods. It's exactly what we were for a little time. It was glorious. No, better than that. We were glorious. Let's turn now to your concluding remarks. You summarize your mathematical principles underpinning your simulations, discuss the complexities involved in comparing the computer model to the observed PMO data, and highlight the excellent agreement seen across all the comparisons, or almost all of them. What are we to make of the discrepancies, slight as they are? They're just residuals, she says, not wanting to be drawn on this point, but also not wanting to make it too obvious that she would rather be moving into safer waters. The sun's angle behind the blinds has shifted during the conversation, and now a spike of brightness is hitting her dead in the eye, making her squint. There's a migraine pressure swelling up somewhere behind her forehead. The worrying thing would be if the model and the data were too close in agreement, because then you'd conclude that one or the other had been fudged. She squints at them expectantly, hoping for the agreement that never comes. Besides, the only way to resolve that discrepancy, small as it is, would be to introduce an unrealistic assumption. What attracts you to the idea of working in Tokyo? Select one or more answers from the options below. Leave blank if you feel none of the options apply. Tokyo is a bustling city with vibrant nightlife. I plan to throw myself into it with abandon. I will never be short of things to do in Tokyo. I have always had a romantic attachment to the idea of living in Japan. I have seen many films and read many comic strips. I am certain that I will not be disappointed by the reality of life in Tokyo. Beyond the university, the city is irrelevant to me. Provided I have somewhere affordable to sleep and access to colleagues, funds, and research equipment, I could live anywhere. I expect to spend most of my time in air-conditioned rooms, staring at computer screens. I could be in Mumbai or Pasadena or Cairo for all the difference it will make. But to go deeper, you must have quailed at the challenge ahead of you. We did. But we also knew no one was better equipped to face it. Slowly, we extended our downward reach. 10,000 kilometers eventually. Feelers tipped with little bubbles of air and cold in which we could survive. The deep photosphere pressing in like a vice made of light, seeking out the tiniest flaw, the slightest weakness. Beneath 300 kilometers, you couldn't see the sky anymore. Just that furious white furnace above and below. But clever alloys and cooling systems had taken us as far as they were capable. Electron degenerate matter was our next advance. The same material white dwarf stars are made out of. A century before we got anywhere with that. Hard enough to crush matter down to the necessary densities, even harder to coax it into some sort of stability. Only the fact of the anomaly kept us going. It provided a sort of existence theorem for our enterprise. An alien machine survives inside the sun, deeper than any layer we've reached. If it can do that, so can we. Hubris? Perhaps. But the truth is, we might as well have been starting science from scratch. It was like reinventing fire, reinventing basic metallurgy. We did it all the same. We sent sounding probes ahead of the main shaft, self-contained machines constructed from shells of sacrificial, degenerate matter, layers of themselves boiled away until all that was left was a hard nugget of cognitive machinery with just enough processing power to swim around, make observations, and signal back to us. They forged a path, tested our new materials and methods. Another century. We pushed our physical presence down to 30,000 kilometers, a borehole drilled halfway to the prize. Conditions were tough, fully murderous. We could send machines to the bottom of the shaft, but not sunwalkers. So we shaped new explorers, discarding our old attachment to arms and legs, heads and hearts. Sunsprites. Sun dragons, I called us. A brain, a nervous system, and then nothing else you'd ever recognize as human. Quick, strong, luminous creatures. Mermaids of light and fire. I became one when they asked. There was never the slightest hesitation. I reveled in what they'd made of me. We could swim beyond the shaft for a little while. Layers of sacrificial armor flaking away from us like old skins. But even the degenerate matter was only a step along the way. Our keenest minds were already anticipating the next phase, when we had to learn the brutal alchemy of nuclear degenerate matter. Another 2 centuries. Creating tools and materials from neutron star material made our games with white dwarf matter look like child's play. Which it was, from our perspective. We'd come a long way. Too far, some said. But still we kept going. What else were we going to do? What do you mean by unrealistic? Look, she says, really feeling that migraine pressure now, her squinting eyes watering at the striped brightness coming through the blinds, a brightness with her name on it. Everyone knows the sun is round. A child will tell you that. Your flag says the same thing. But actually the sun is really quite unreasonably round. It's so round that it's practically impossible to measure any difference between the diameter at the poles and the diameter at the equator. And if a thing's round on the outside, that's a fairly large hint that it's symmetric all the way through to the middle. You could explain away the residuals by adding an asymmetric term into the solar interior, but it really wouldn't make any sense to do so. And nor, she thinks, would it make sense to introduce that term anyway, then run many simulations springing from it, then compare them against the data over and over, hoping that the complication, like the cherry blossoms, will fall away at the first strong breeze, a transient business soon to be forgotten. They stare at her with a sort of polite anticipation, as if there is something more she ought to have said, something that would clear the air and allow them to proceed. They are concerned for her, she thinks, or at least puzzled. Her gaze slips past theirs, drawn to the pattern behind the blinds, the play of dust and light and shadow, as if there is some encouraging or discouraging signal buried in that information, hers for the reading. But instead, they ask to see a graph of the residuals. Can you be certain of our fate? Yes, as I'm sure of it as anyone can be. Obviously, there are difficulties of translation. After all the centuries, after all the adaptive changes wrought on me, my mind is very far from that of a baseline human. Having said that, I am still much, much closer to you than I am to the anomaly. And no matter what you may make of me, no matter how strange you now find me, this being that can swim inside a star, this sun dragon of degenerate matter who could crush your ships and stations as easily as she blinks, you must know that I feel a kinship. I am still human. I am still Kamala Chatterjee, and I remember what I once used to be. I remember Mumbai. I remember my parents. I remember their kindness in helping me follow my education. I remember grazing my shins in football. I remember the burn of grass on my palm. I remember sun-dappled paths, paper lanterns, and evening airs. I remember Kuroshio, although you do not. And I call myself one of you, and hope that my account of things is accurate. And if I am correct, and I have no reason to think otherwise, then I am afraid there is very little ambiguity about our fate. When I touched the anomaly, I suddenly knew its purpose. It's been waiting for us, primed to respond. Sitting inside the sun like a bomb. An alien time bomb. Oh, you needn't worry about that. The sun won't explode, and tongues of fire won't lash out against Earth and the other worlds. Nothing so melodramatic. No. What will happen, what is happening, is far subtler. Kinder, you might say. You and I live in the moment. We have come to this point in our history, encountered the anomaly, and now we ponder the consequences of that event. But the anomaly's perception isn't like that. Its view of us is atemporal. We're more like a family tree than a species. It sees us as a decision branch structure frozen in time, a set of histories radiating out from critical points. An entity that has grown into a particular complex shape, interacted with the anomaly across multiple contact points, and which must now be pruned. Cut back. Stripped of its petals as the summer winds strip a cherry blossom. I can feel it happening. I think some of it rubbed off on me, and now I'm a little bit spread out, a little bit smeared across some of these histories, some of these branches, becoming atemporal. And I can feel those branches growing thinner, withering back from their point of contact, as if they've touched a poison. Can you feel it too? No, I didn't think so. If you were offered a placement, when do you think you would be able to start your research? Select one or more answers from the options below. Leave blank if you feel none of the options apply. I would be able to start within a few months, once I have settled my affairs in my home country. I would like to start immediately. I am eager to begin my doctoral work. I would like time to consider the offer. We feel that the thesis cannot be considered complete without a thorough treatment of the residual terms. A proper characterization of these terms will lead to a clearer picture of the anomaly that seems to be implied by the current analysis. This will entail several more months of work. Are you prepared to accept this commitment? A moment grows longer, becomes awkward in its attenuation. She feels their eyes on her, willing her to break the silence. But it has already gone on long enough. There can be no way to speak now that will not cast a strange, eccentric light on her behavior. That light coming through the window feels unbearably full of meaning, demanding total commitment to the act of observation. Her throat moves. She swallows, feeling herself pinned to this moving instant in space and time, paralyzed by it. Her migraine feels less like a migraine and more like a window opening inside her head, letting in futures. Vast possibilities unfold from this moment. Terrifying futures, branching away faster and more numerous than thoughts can track. There is a weight on her that she never asked for, never invited. A pressure sharpening down to a point like the tip of a diamond anvil. There's a version of her that did something magnificent and terrible. She traces the contingent branches back in time until they converge on this office, this moment, this choice. Agree to their request, or fail. She gathers her notes and rises to leave. She smooths her skirt. They watch her without question, faces blank. Her actions so far outside the usual parameters that her interrogators have no frame of reference. I have to go to the park again, she says, as if that ought to be answer enough, all that was required of her. It's still Hanami. There's still time. They watch as Kamala Chatterjee closes the door behind her. She goes to Ueno Park, wanders the cherry blossom paths, remaining there until the lantern lighters come, and an evening cool touches the air.
Chapter 2 6 Degrees of Freedom by Pat Cadigan. "What's the catch?" Dory asked, when it became clear no one else would. Dr. Reka Enescu looked down at her from her elevated able chair. She had a face full of freeze, trademark, but Dory's enhanced eyesight detected a hint of a smile. "The catch is, you can't come back." A murmur ran through the rest of the room, except for Dory, who was sitting alone in the front row of the auditorium. This would be the hell no for a lot of them. People who had never experienced a large-scale disaster, natural or man-made, tended to balk at no going back. They didn't like a situation with no undo button, even if they had no intention of using it. They just wanted to know they could. Undo, redo, save and exit. Exit without saving, as if everything could be edited or done over. Dory blamed old software architecture, that, and endless entertainment reboots. Dr. Enescu looked at someone behind Dory and nodded. "Yes?" A man cleared his throat. "Why are you refusing to let people come back? People should be allowed to go home if they want to." The woman hesitated. She was tired of answering this question. Dory didn't blame her. "It's not a matter of refusing to let people come back," Dr. Enescu said. "It's the distances involved. Jupiter is over 4 times farther away from the Earth than the Earth is to the Sun. It takes light over 30 minutes to go from Earth to Jupiter, which isn't an easy journey for—" "Is that when Jupiter is closest, or when it's farthest?" another man asked, then added, "Never mind, I looked it up." "It's not just the distance," Dr. Enescu said sharply. "It's also the physical adaptations to the human body. We evolved to live under the constant force of 1G. In order to survive in a weightless environment, changes have to be made. For example, in 0G, the heart doesn't need to work harder to pump blood into the upper body. We also have to counter muscle atrophy, bone loss." "The whole body has to be changed?" the first man asked, sounding unhappy.
"I'm afraid so," Dr. Enescu said. "And a body adapted to live in 0G can't survive on Earth."
"What if you don't want your body adapted?" the first man said.
"We aren't trying to force anyone to agree to the procedure before we'll even talk to them," Dr. Enescu replied. "Body modification is a deeply personal matter, and no one should be coerced into doing something, or not doing it. However, if you can't even bring yourself to consider adaptation as a hypothetical, this is probably not for you."
Dory turned around. About a third of the audience in the auditorium were making their way to the exit at the back. Once they were gone, Dr. Enescu asked the remaining people to move closer to the front. Most did, some didn't. The usual 5% who might stay but wanted to make an inconspicuous exit if they decided to leave. It was the same at every event. When had human behavior become so predictable? Dory wondered. Or was it only apparent to her now because of her enhanced vision?
"I have to admit, I'm rather surprised most people don't understand physical adaptation is mandatory, not optional," Dr. Enescu said when everyone was settled. A small dark curl dropped down onto her forehead. As she raised her hand to tuck it back into place, Dory caught a glimpse up her sleeve of the exoskeleton.
Enescu had said wearing it made her feel like a puppet that was also a puppeteer. On Earth, that was, in 0G, it was completely different. She only had another week before she left Earth for the last time, but it would be a pretty full week. All spinal injury clinics and amputee rehab facilities. Dory wished her own schedule allowed her to sit in on some of those.
"Hearing about it and having someone tell you face to face are two different things," said the man who had asked about Jupiter's nearest and farther points. There were murmurs of agreement.
"But is it really irreversible?" an androgyne in the row behind Dory asked.
"Are you planning to reverse your own physical form?" Dr. Enescu replied evenly. As she lowered her hand from her hair, the armrest angled up to meet it and brought it down the rest of the way. She should have been in a reclining position, but Inescu was one of those people who had to do everything the hard way.
Absolutely not, said the androgyne with a laugh. But I can survive anywhere on Earth, both as I was and as I am now.
Not anywhere, Honey Bear, said the androgyne next to him, her, with a grim laugh.
You know what I mean, the first androgyne said, elbowing her, him. My heart would beat, I could breathe. Until the fundamentalist commandos found your hideout, said his, her friend with a laugh.
The first androgyne elbowed her, him harder.
And while we're on the subject, what about us? Do you only take binaries?
Adaptation has nothing to do with gender, Dr. Inescu said.
So the stories about androgynes waking up and finding they've been assigned to be male or female without their permission aren't true? The first androgyne said, sounding slightly suspicious.
Dr. Inescu let out a breath that wasn't quite a sigh.
To my knowledge, no one has been assigned or reassigned a gender against their will.
A lot of things happen to us that no one knows about, the second androgyne said darkly. Until it's too late anyway.
Dr. Inescu lowered her chair from eye level standing height to eye level sitting.
Not in space, she said, her voice quiet but firm. In space, nothing happens in secret.
Dory waited for someone to realize Inescu had just divulged the real catch.
Oh, the androgyne said after a moment. So nobody gets experimented on? Unless they want to be, added his, her friend.
Absolutely not.
For the first time, Dr. Inescu sounded annoyed and didn't try to cover it. Adaptation clinics aren't set up for research or experimental medicine.
And if you did want to be experimented on, asked someone many rows back, after you got adapted, what if you wanted to participate in?
Not my area, Dr. Inescu said, cordial but emphatic. I'm only here to find people who might be interested in living and working in space, not to find subjects for medical trials.
Silence fell and stretched. Dory turned around for another look at the audience and was a bit surprised to see that no one else had left. Finally, another woman in the front row on Dory's right said,
I'd like to see the video again.
There was a chorus of agreement, so Dr. Inescu obligingly lowered the tank and ran the entire hollow from the beginning. Only one person sneaked out when the lights dimmed. Everyone else sat through the entire 20 minutes of what Dory thought of as a cross between the Ain't Science Great edumercials they showed underachievers in elementary school and the Don't Kill Yourself Yet, You Can Train for a New Career, Really You Can, No Joke programs the recently fired found in their severance packages. Not that it wasn't right for the audience, some of whom probably had been recently fired. In this particular part of the country, however, most of them were not so recently fired and getting desperate. The rest would include a mix of those fresh out of higher education with no prospects, those insisting they were only curious, and some dissatisfied souls wondering if this might be the escape hatch they were looking for. Even so, how many of them would take the next step and sign a provisional commitment was a crapshoot. It didn't matter how good the video was or how compelling the speaker. Sometimes you got almost everyone in the audience lining up, thumbs out to be scanned. Other times, you got maybe two or three who all backed out the moment they saw the scanner. And once in a while, not nearly as often as Dory would have thought, someone would say, wait a second, what do you mean, in space, nothing happens in secret? Then things would get really interesting. Everyone might walk out, except for a few who wanted to debate privacy issues. Or they all might stay and argue, not just with a speaker, but with each other, which could be entertaining, but otherwise a total failure. Still, IRL events were proving to be a far better way to recruit for the Habitats Project than casts, even those done live in real time. There were billions of casts on tap, and most of them were more interesting than a factual presentation about living in outer space. In Dory's experience, The best way to persuade people to physically go somewhere was to get them to physically go somewhere. They needed to experience their own 6 degrees of freedom. Plus, bodies in motion tended to stay in motion. A lot of people attended several different IRL events, one after another, seemingly to wear down their own resistance. The hard sell of eat this, wear that, stop, listen, watch, they experienced every day was verboten at recruitment events. Research showed that in many areas of the West, decades, correction, generations of exposure to aggressive media had produced people who never said yes to anything the first time around for fear of looking weak. If it's that important, they won't take no for an answer, were words most people lived by. It made a classic lesson in strain energy and positive feedback. Outside the classroom, however, Dory found it more than a little tiring. Recruitment had originally wanted to go with the hard sell. Dory had spent most of 2 days changing their minds. Even with real facts and figures to show them, it had been the hardest sell of her career, an irony that wasn't lost on her. Later, one of the execs told Dory he was surprised she hadn't given up. Dory had smiled and murmured something polite, but didn't try to explain. The exec was organization and admin. He understood flow within an existing structure as an end user, not as a designer. That was all right. End users weren't supposed to think in those terms. If they did, it was a bad structure. Nonetheless, Dory thought that if most end users were slightly better acquainted with the how and why of their tools, they'd have found them easier to use. The mentor on her final apprenticeship, a tall, muscular, gray-haired industrial design specialist named Fola Ekemeni, had agreed wholeheartedly. "That's a great idea," she told Dory. "I'll set up the first round of accredited seminars myself, just as soon as you engineer 3 or 4 more hours into each day. Even better, remodel the week so we get 8 days instead of 7, and I'll pin a rose on you too." Dory was still smiling at the memory when the lights came up again. Dr. Inescu asked for more questions. When no one had any, she asked if anyone wanted to make a personal appointment, which made Dory wince. She thought, personal appointment sounded like something guaranteed to bore you to death. Inescu explained it was a one-to-one meeting with someone who would get to know them well enough to talk about possibilities based on an initial assessment of their strengths. Inescu never said strengths and weaknesses, just strengths. It was an Inescu thing. "Everyone knows their weaknesses," she had said when Dory asked her about it. "You want people demonstrating what they're good at, not hiding what they're bad at." Dory thought she'd have made a good engineer, but then that was true of most X-abled people. Very few of them were content to be just end users. A little over half the people in the audience lined up for the scanner. Inescu took care of that without Dory's help. Another one of her things. It went quickly, even with a few people suddenly thinking of questions. But by the time everyone left, Inescu was visibly sagging, except for her face, which was as smooth and immobile as ever. What's the catch? The freeze hadn't even begun to wear off yet, but Inescu gave a small laugh. "I think that's the only question I wasn't expecting." "Can't prove it by me. You didn't even hesitate." Dory smiled broadly. Maybe a bit too broadly. Inescu probably thought she looked like a jackass in mid-hee-haw, but she couldn't help it. After she spent an extended period of time around someone who was all freezed up, she'd get a compulsion to take on the facial expressions that were temporarily beyond the other person. It was one of her things, kind of weird, but to Dory's mild surprise, not all that rare. Maybe she should open up a side business. Faces in places. We'll smile at you, or for you. Reasonable rates. "Well, I actually didn't know what I was going to say till I said it." Inescu seemed to sink even deeper into the cushioned cradle in the back seat of the limo. Transport. Nobody called them limos now. During the last economic debacle, the word limo had become closely associated with a certain kind of wealth and privilege that was both clueless and heartless. In some areas, even town car was iffy. "I didn't mean to throw you." Dory could feel her facial muscles straining to corroborate her concern. Maybe she needed a little freeze herself, just so she wouldn't sprain her forehead.
Oh, you didn't really thrill me.
Enescu's conciliatory tone completely contradicted her neutral mask.
I've been doing this for a while, and I've heard all kinds of kooky shite.
Kooky? Dory immediately broke into a broad grin. Now, there was a word you hardly ever heard anymore. It was a good one. Dory made a mental note to start using it herself.
Can't say it hasn't been fun, Enescu went on. I'm an extrovert with a streak of exhibitionism, so this kind of gig is right in my sweet spot. But I'm looking forward to wrapping this up and losing weight for good. I was only up for 3 weeks, but that was enough. She looked down at her hands, resting on the lap cushion. No matter how light or flexible or intuitive they are supposed to be, every exo I've ever had made me feel like a sack full of sticks and water balloons. But in zero-G, you can actually forget you're even using one. It was the first time I'd felt like myself since fate crapped on me.
Dory stared, hoping she looked more attentively caring than Kabuki.
Damn, I'm sorry, Enescu said unhappily. I talk too much when I get freezed up. I think I'm subconsciously trying to compensate for the poker face, if that makes any sense to you.
You know, it really does, Dory assured her. She considered telling Enescu about her own tic in that area, and then decided not to. Giving end users extra information in a social setting was more likely to distract than edify. Besides, she could do much more with what she learned from Enescu than Enescu could do with anything Dory might tell her.
I won't see you again after this, will I? Enescu said.
Dory shook her head.
That's probably also part of it. We'll never meet again, so I run off at the mouth. I did enjoy working with you, though.
It was kind of you to agree to fill in for Dr. Hupperton, Dory told her.
I didn't mind. It was...
She paused for so long, Dory wondered if she were going to continue.
It was nothing, she said finally. It was easy, and the extra value I'm getting for it doesn't hurt. Can you explain how that works? Value, I mean.
Well, Dory grimaced, suddenly stuck. To be perfectly honest, no. Enescu burst out laughing. Her immobilized face made it sound as odd as it looked.
I'm sorry, I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing at the value system and the brain boxes who thought it up. I've asked a whole bunch of people if they can explain how it works. About half said they can't. The rest actually tried. I told them, talk to me like I'm stupid. I don't mind. But I'm too stupid, I guess, because I still can't make heads or tails or good red herring out of any of it. Economic engineering, my sweet tetraplegic ass.
The value system is a lot like time, Dory said. We know it, we use it, we live with it and buy it. But try taking a close look at what it is, and you might as well try gluing strawberry jelly to a ghost.
Enescu laughed harder this time. Damn, I wish this shite would wear off already, she said after a bit. If I can't crack a smile soon, I'm gonna get a lip hernia or something.
Now it was Dory's turn to laugh. Try decreasing your dosage by an eighth next time, she suggested.
Next time, I'm decreasing it to zero, Enescu said. If I go into a room full of exibles with this face, I'll get my ass handed to me in a million pieces.
Dory frowned. Have you talked that over with recruitment?
No, I just told them. That's my deal. When I'm going to talk to the extra-enabled, I go in barefaced. They need to know I'm not trying to hide anything. Exibles see too much of this shite.
She jerked both thumbs in the general direction of her head.
Hell, if I ever sub for someone with a general audience again, I'll do it barefaced or not at all. I don't know what I was thinking, agreeing to be more paralyzed.
Dory's enhanced vision caught a tiny movement at the corner of Enescu's mouth, the first sign the freeze was finally letting go. Dory felt relieved for her, for both of them, really. Her own facial muscles were so tired, The corners of her mouth quivered when she smiled.
So, where do you go from here? Inescu asked her.
Kyrgyzstan, Dory said.
I think I felt my eyebrows go up half a millimeter, Inescu said.
Your eyes definitely widened, Dory told her.
It was true.
Damn. Who did you piss off? Jesus?
His dad, actually.
Good one, Inescu said. I'm stealing it. Use it in good health. Actually, I don't mind. I've never been to Kyrgyzstan.
Is there even room? I caught the news earlier. It looks like wall-to-wall refugees.
Is recruitment counting on signing up a lot of people who have nowhere to go?
I wouldn't know. I don't actually work for recruitment, Dory said politely. I mean, I do, but I'm a consultant, not a salaried employee.
A tiny indentation appeared over Inescu's right eyebrow. Her eyes looked up as if she could actually see it.
Aha! I felt that. Thank God. I should be able to make funny faces by dinner time. What do you consult on?
I specialize in population movements due to environmental change, either sudden or over some period of time, like maybe a decade.
Specialize how? What do you do? Observe? Predict? Enable?
Inescu's eyes widened again. I was going to say prevent, but that ship has left the dock, and it ain't coming back.
Dory hesitated. I cope, she said finally. I figure out how to cope. As part of a team, of course, not just me by myself.
So how do you cope?
That's what we have to figure out, how the refugees can cope, how the already established population can cope, and how everyone around them can cope. It ripples out a very long way.
I'm sure, Inescu gave a short laugh. Recruiting them to live in space could be a pretty good solution.
I agree, Dory said. But first, they have to cope.
Oh, Inescu blinked at her. I'm sorry, I guess I don't really understand what you do. I thought I did.
It's okay, Dory said. It's like time.
And the value system? Inescu's eyes twinkled.
Kyrgyzstan wasn't wall-to-wall refugees. Inescu had apparently confused it with one of the stands on the other side of the Caspian Sea. But its population had risen quite a bit, and it would continue to increase as temperatures in parts of the Indian subcontinent went from difficult to impossible. Dory split her time between two groups, one looking at possible channels for the flow of migration, and the other trying to measure the strain energy at various destinations. Her last 2 weeks, she spent with a team commissioned by a multi-nation consortium to design underground living space, not in theory, but in fact, unquote. The engineers, Dory included, had a good laugh about that.
As if we ever work any other way, said the foreperson, an androgyne named Revere Evershed. His original specialty had actually been landscapes, and he was always trying to get more green space into every design.
Seriously, you people don't realize how much green you're used to in your life,
he said, when someone challenged one of his ideas for an oasis parklet.
Even if you're completely urban, you see it, and you don't even know you're seeing it. You've got trees growing up out of the sidewalks. You've got flowering shrubs all over apartment complexes and office buildings, inside and out. In Manhattan, hell, there's friggin' ivy climbing the Empire State Building.
That's an urban myth, said one of the geologists. Those photos are all fakes. Evershed was unmoved.
Okay, if that isn't real, it ought to be. Getting daylight in is only half the solution. If they don't see it shining on living things other than themselves, they're all gonna turn into Morlocks.
About half the team, Dory included, got the reference. Evershed looked at those who hadn't and shook his head sadly.
The benefits of a classical education cannot be overstated, he said. I'd make you all read The Time Machine as homework, but there aren't enough hours in the day already for what they want us to do.
Dory hoped Evershed never found out she was only familiar with some of the later film adaptations.
Judging from the micro-expressions she'd picked up, she wasn't alone. Still, she thought Evershed was right, and before she left, she invited her him for coffee at a cafe in the nearby village. "I know all about the Habitats Project," Evershed told her. They were sitting outside at a small metal table that had seen much better days, most likely in the previous century. The mismatched wooden chairs looked even older, but were surprisingly solid and just as uncomfortable. "They've sent headhunters at me a few times, once since I've been here. I guess you make it twice." Dory considered telling him her this hadn't been a headhunting assignment for her, and decided not to, at least for the moment. Making people feel sought after was never a bad thing. "I believe in the project," she said. "I believe it can work. I believe it will work. And I believe you're just what they need. I'm flattered, but I'm committed, as you know." Dory couldn't resist. "And as you know, Bob, I do." They laughed together. "But you're not nailed to the ground permanently," she went on. "When your contract expires, or when they replace you with a fresh perspective, whichever, and you're looking around for your next job, try looking up." Evershed flicked a glance at the sky, which was clouded over, featureless and vague. "Leave everything I've ever known? Die in space? What about my family? I thought you didn't have children." Evershed grinned in a way that reminded Dory of a very old drawing of a smiling cat she'd seen once. "What if I did?" "That might be a harder sell," Dory admitted, a bit sheepishly. "Aren't you recruiting families?" Dory hesitated. "Nobody's turning them away, but things get complicated when not all the parents or guardians want to emigrate. There have also been cases where everyone in the immediate family is good to go, but other relatives file a legal restraint to keep the minors on Earth, usually because they didn't want to lose their grandchildren. A few minors have requested emancipation, some because they want to stay on Earth, but most because they don't. Some places have made it illegal to take anyone under the age of consent into space with intent to remain permanently, even if there's no conflict and the whole family is ready for launch. If they can't consent to sex, they can't consent to an elective life-altering procedure." Evershed gave a small laugh. "I get the reasoning, but that's going to end up biting something it wasn't supposed to." "It already has," Dory assured him. "And it's a mess. There's nothing in the known universe that could persuade me to be a lawyer." "Hey, a lawyer's just an engineer wearing roller skates and a straitjacket." Evershed laughed again. "A lawyer told me that one." The androgyne's smile faded. "I've spent my whole life solving problems here. I think I'm too old to change." "I doubt you're much older than I am," Dory said. "Do you really want to spend the rest of your working life figuring out the best way to bury people alive?" Evershed winced. "I wish everyone would stop referring to it like that. We're solving the problem of survival in a hostile environment. Is it really so different from the Habitats Project? You can live underground on Earth or in a pressurized can in outer space, which I'd say is a much more hostile environment. And what about Mars? Everybody there lives underground. What's so great about being buried alive there?" "If you ask me, nothing," Dory said. "If you ask the colonists, they'll say it's the lighter gravity. Physical activity is different when you weigh a little over a third of what you do on Earth. They have their own versions of baseball and dance. They've also reinvented pinball, with humans instead of balls, which really brings in the tourists. Some people would rather go to the moon, where the gravity's less than half of Mars. But they actually don't let you bounce around as much there." She smiled. "I prefer no gravity myself." "You're doing this to lose weight?" Dory had lost count of the number of times she'd heard that joke, but she laughed with Evershed anyway. "Actually, I'm in it for the new challenges, new problems that need solving. During the relatively brief time I spent in the habitats orbiting Jupiter, I could actually see their society taking shape." "Habitats, plural? How many are there?" "3 so far. They're still in progress, but people have moved in. And as they go on building and adding to them, there'll be more." "What if there aren't?" Evershed asked. "What if they build these great big tin cans, habitats, and people decide they'd rather be underground on Earth than live in a space can millions of miles away from everything they've ever known.
Dory shrugged. There's more than one way to get more people. They're already having kids out there.
Evershed looked shocked. Do they adapt babies right after birth, or wait till they're toddlers?
Dory shook her head. Epigenetics. Kids are born adapted. The androgyne stared, then finished the rest of his coffee in one go.
That may not play well down here, messing with Mother Nature like that.
But screwing up the climate so much that people have to live underground, nobody has a problem with that, Dory said, a bit sourly.
I didn't say I felt that way, but it'll be one more thing making recruitment harder for you. Space humans give birth to mutant monster babies. There hasn't been clickbait that good in, I don't know, 30 years, maybe 50. You'll have your work cut out for you.
Well, not me personally, Dory said. I'm on contract with Jovop's recruitment, in exchange for services rendered. They'll cover surgical adaptation all the way through to recovery, and then make sure I end up in a place where they need people like me.
You can get work anywhere, down here or up there. You're an engineer.
I'm a civil engineer, Dory corrected him. Out there, there's a lot more than infrastructure. Although I don't ignore infrastructure, which is why I'd really like to get you out of the dirt, too. Will you think about it? How the hell do you plant a garden with no gravity? You'd have to pack the dirt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.